To our seminar.
Okay.
So our speaker today is Xiaoming Yuan from University of Hong Kong. So it is our first speaker in Asia. Yeah? It is 9 o'clock.
Yeah.
9 p.m. in Hong Kong. Yeah? Thank you, Xiaoming, for accepting our invitation. Yeah? And for giving this talk at this late time. Yeah? It is probably the first talk you give so late. Yeah. So Xiaoming will talk about some approach, like going from optimization to optimal control. Yeah? And I met Xiaoming the first time, I guess, in Hong Kong. Yeah, but he was at that time in the Baptist University of Hong Kong. He moved in the meantime to University of Hong Kong. And then we met in several other places. Yeah? Last year in Erice, yeah? it was very nice. Yeah? It was before Corona, and hopefully we will meet again in real, let's say next year. Why not? So, Xiaoming, it's time.
Right, thank you. Thank you, Radu. Yeah, also, I would like to thank Shahom and Matthews for the very nice invitation. And I miss Vienna very much, but unfortunately, we can't give the talk in my office. Okay. And today I'm going to talk something actually quite new for me. I'm going to talk something about optimal control. And I'm going to focus on some algorithm design to solve some optimal control problems with PDE constraints. This is a joint work with my students, Yun Chun Song and Henry Yue. Basically, they did everything. So I just present the result on behalf of them. So they pushed me a lot to learn PDE. Okay, so the talk, I'm trying to make the talk on the entrance level, because I'm still learning something on this topic. So I start from the PD, optimal control. So, you know, when we mention optimal control, usually we mean we want to control a given system over a period of time.
Sorry for interrupting. Can you switch to full screen or like in larger slides?
Sure. Is that better?
Yeah, very good. Okay.
How can I remove the video? Okay, all right. Yeah. So this is the definition of optimal control. So we want to control some system usually over a period of time, such as some objective is achieved. Okay, and the system usually can be described by some differential equations, ODE or PDE, and it's probably integral equations or difference equations, etc. And in this talk, I'm going to focus on some PDE-related optimal control problems. Okay, meaning we want to control some physical, procedures given by PDE. Okay, and time-dependent. Okay, so PDE usually, model some physical phenomena such as, standard applications are, for example, diffusion, heat flow, fluid flow, elastic deformation, wave propagation, et cetera, and so we have the elliptic equations, parabolic, hyperbolic, and the Navier-Stokes equations, and so on. So we need sometimes we need to control this kind of equations by some objectives. Okay, so for some applications, we need not only to model some certain physical process, but also control the the process to meet some objectives optimally. So that's give us the problem of PDE constraints to optimization. Okay, and a given objective functional, usually a functional in dimension space, has to be minimized subject to a PDE or a system of coupled PDE. And sometimes we have some other additional constraints in addition to PDE or PDEs. Okay, I will show you some applications later. Okay, so basically, we're discussing how to solve some PDE constraints optimization problems today. Okay, so that's the topic. To give you an example, this is the elastic deformation application. Suppose we have some force to place on the bottom of the body, and then the was given actually by the so-called Navier-Cauchy equation. Okay, so our purpose is to minimize the external forces to drive the body from a given shape to a target one. Like, for example, this original shape, and then we want to have this shape, and then how to minimize the forces to make the shape, you know, change from the original one to the target one. And then this is a standard optimization problem, the subject to the Navier-Cauchy equation. This is PD constraints. And then some other ones comes from chemistry actually. Suppose we put, you know, some liquids or some gas together and make them to react each other with each other. And then the, you know, the reaction among these reactants can be modeled by a system of PDEs. In particular, maybe we have some Navier-Stokes equations in the PDE system. And then we have to have some external factors to, you know, to affect this this chemical react. For example, the temperature and the pressure or the flow rate of the reactants. And then all of these factors actually appears as the source term or the boundary conditions in the system of PDEs. And then our purpose is to control these external factors to maximize the reaction rate. Okay, so this is another application we call the reactive flow simulation problems. Okay, and then this is a very difficult problem because it's because the constraints is a Navier-Stokes equation, and usually theoretically we cannot get many new results. So we can only do simulation. We can only do numerical results, algorithm designs for simulating this kind of procedure. All of these applications actually, we have many others, okay? So for this kind of applications with PDE constraints. Okay, so I use the language of Leon's, okay? And so a PDE constraint optimal control problem can be actually represented by the following abstract way. So we have an objective function and we have two variables, U and Y. And U basically is the variable we want to control. For example, the temperature I just mentioned in the last example. And then Y is the variable for the state. So what U and the Y actually are related by the equation, which could be a PDE equation. So Y is the state, U is the variable. And how Y depends on U is given by this this differential equation. And then we have an objective to be achieved. So this objective function is relying on U and Y. Okay, and sometimes we have some additional constraints to the variable U and Y. For example, we maybe want to control the variable within a given region, within a given set. So we call it a convex. So sometimes where UAD and YAD are some smaller sets in the space. Okay, and then we want to control the variable only within this set. Okay, and then this. Okay, I think I explained this in the model already. So in this talk, we only consider the linear case of the state equation, meaning if you use optimization with this optimization technology, this is just a convex case, okay? And of course, this is relatively easier compared to some nonlinear PDE constraints. Okay, so to classify different PDE constraints to optimizing problems, usually we have this following three cases. The unconstrained case, meaning both Y and U have no additional constraints. Well, they could be, both of them could be the whole space. Okay, and sometimes we have a constraints on the control variable, as I said. For example, we want to control some temperature within a given region, and then we have additional constraints. Usually we have box constraints. For some example, I'm going to discuss. And then sometimes we need the state to be, you know, constraints in some specific area. So we have some additional constraints for the state variable Y. So usually we can classify these kind of problems into these three cases. Okay, so today, so let's say a parabolic optimal control problem. Today we're going to focus on parabolic. Okay, parabolic is time dependent. It should be more difficult than the elliptic equations. Okay, so this is the standard parabolic optimal control problem. Okay, so this is the boundary condition. This is the initial condition, and this is the parabolic equation. So Y and the U actually are governed by this differential equation, and then we have an objective in this way. So Y minus YD basically means we want to control the state Y. We want to make the state Y be very close to a desired state YD, okay? YD means the desired state. And then we want to use the minimum energy, okay? U is the variable we can control, but we want to minimize the energy. So we have two objectives, so put them together, and they are, you know, trade-off by a constant alpha. Alpha usually is very small in practice. Okay, and then as I said, if you consider some additional constant to the control or state variable, then we have some box constraints on the control and state variables. Okay, depending on the property, depending on the applications. And then I'll give you a example about the heating resource control. Okay, so if we consider a heating process for a metal bar, and it's well known actually the temperature distribution of the bar can be modeled by the heat equation. The heat equation is a special case of the state equation here when the nu is equal to one, the A0 is equal to zero. Okay, so the temperature distribution on the bar, on the metal bar, and the heating resource actually can be described by the state variable and the control variable, respectively. Now we want to know, we want to control the heating process in order that the state Y is in a small neighborhood of the desired temperature distribution. So we have a target distribution of the temperature YD, as I said. So generally, of course, we cannot expect Y is precisely equal to YD. So we hope they are very close. So that's why we have this first term in the objective. So Y and YD should be very close. And we need this term should be minimized, ideally. And we have a regularization term, as I said. We want to use the minimum energy, okay, to minimize this term. So that's why we have this term. And mathematically, this term actually can make the problem, you know.
We have a question.
Yes.
So what were the subscripts on U in the first constraint?
What? Can you say it again?
So can you go back to the problem? So where there was a constraint, okay.
Yeah. This U and Y, right? We have some additional constraints for U and Y. Yeah, sometimes we have the box constraints. So A and B. So
Jonathan.
Okay. All right. So we want to control the the temperature. Okay. We want to make the temperature, you know, be close to the desired temperature, and then we have to minimize this term plus the, you know, the energy function. And then, of course, sometimes we have the control constraints in order to make sure actually the required heating energy is attainable. Okay, because we don't want sometimes the energy too large or too small. And also the state constraints, meaning physically, we can these constraints can be used to prevent some possible extremely high or extremely low temperature in the heating process, because this kind of extreme cases are not good because they may destroy the bar. Okay, this is a quite useful model in industrial. Okay, and they use this kind of control system to control the production. Okay, and the temperature, and the state of the art. So you know, we only have 1 hour, and we cannot discuss everything. So there are many works in the huge literature in optimal control, and many of them are discussing, for example, the existence and the regularity of the optimal solution. And PD, the main topic is talking about how to numerically discretize the schemes. Okay, discretize the problems. And then there, as I said, there are many applications to discuss. So, but today we are just to focus on the case that actually when the dimension of space is high. High means this is not the one dimension, it's two or three dimensions for the space. And when the case is time dependent, as mentioned for the parabolic case. And then for this kind of case, we don't have too many numeric solvers. Okay, mainly because of the dimension after the space and the time discretization, the dimension is really high. Okay, I'm going to give you some figures to see how high the dimension will be. So we want to discuss some algorithm design for these problems, especially actually I'm going to show you some ideas for solving the regular, easier convex optimization problems can be used, okay, for solving this kind of quite challenging problems, optimal control problems. Okay, and so the challenges, okay, we can see actually from the PDE perspectives, we can see first of all the model are generally very complicated, as you can see, and particularly the PDEs and some other constraints like the box constraints on the control and the state variables, they are coupled together. This give us a particular difficulties to design algorithm. And then, you know, for solving some PDs, it's themselves is already very, very difficult. Okay, especially for the time dependence case and some nonlinear PDs, they are very difficult to solve. And some result from PDE cannot be, you know, just extended directly to optimal control. Okay, that's why we have to, you know, deliberately consider the algorithm design for optimal control problems. So from optimization perspective, you know, we have some additional difficulties. For example, as mentioned, the high dimension. The dimension after the discretization of PDE could be easily up to, you know, billions. Okay, that's why we need to be very careful for solving these kind of problems numerically. Okay, and second is actually on top of the, you know, the large scale of the dimension of the system, the system could be extremely ear conditioned. The condition number is huge. Okay, sometimes, and then that means we cannot, you know, apply some solvers directly. We have to be very careful for the preconditioning. Okay, and theoretically we also have some difficulties. For example, when we have some additional constraints for the control or state variable, and then easily we have some nonsense, you know, properties in the optimal condition. And if we consider some nonlinear PDE, then we have some non-convexity. Okay, and also the space, the variable of the dimension is not a finite. Many this kind of difficulties. So we cannot just simply, you know, just combine some existing solvers, you know, straightforwardly. That's usually, basically that doesn't work, okay, for most of the problems. So we need to design, we need to try to, you know, use mathematics to design some algorithms, particularly for some particular problems. So the general recipe is, okay, we have to consider the structure and the properties of the model. So if you want to design some algorithms better, okay. And of course, we need a lot of, for this kind of problems, we need a lot of expertise, but like we need function analysis results to do the convergence analysis. And then we need some optimal control theory to get to make sure, you know, the problem is meaningful. Then we need the optimization for the algorithms. We need the PDE solvers for the discretization. And then we need linear algebra for the large scale and the ear condition system linear equations. And then we need the numerical analysis to make sure the solver is stable. Okay, numerically. So we need, this is a really fusion topic. We need a lot of knowledge to do this kind of things. Okay. And then let's see, very quick review for the unconstrained case. Okay, for the unconstrained case, I mean, we don't have constraints for the variable U and Y. This problem, if we write the optimality condition, this is just a linear set of point problems. It's relatively easier compared to others. Okay, so we have the so-called black box approach and the one-shot approach. The black box approach means actually we consider the, you know, the state equation, you know, the PDE involved equation just as a black box. And we assume, okay, we know the result of the PDE once we give an input. And then we just solve this problem as just like a traditional optimization problem. We can use CG, we can use whatever you like. And then the one-shot approach just solve the optimality condition directly. Okay, we just write the optimality condition and then we solve them. Okay, this is two most important, you know, approaches for the unconscious case. And for the state conscious case, I think the most difficult problem, or the first issues we have to tackle is actually how to guarantee the existence of the Lagrangian multiplier associated with the state constraints. Okay, that's the key problems in this kind of approach. And then we have some other penalty method. I don't want to go into detail. Basically, I think the dominating method is the so-called smooth Newton method, semi-smooth Newton method, SSN. Okay, this is so far the most popular solvers for these kind of problems. And the control constraints, this is the case I'm going to discuss soon. Okay, so for the control constraints case, this problem can be reformulated as a nonlinear set of one problem. I mean the optimality condition. So it's generally is more difficult. And of course we can apply semi-smooth Newton method as well. Okay. We have some books to discuss how to solve semi-smooth Newton. And we can also use interior point methods. Okay. But our recipe for this particular problem is kind of different from the existing one. So in short, our recipe is, okay, we want to decouple the PDE with other constraints. You'll see why I want to do this. Because, you know, sometimes, you know, the PDE is coupled. ones first, and then we can focus on solving the PDE. Okay, so we solve the decoupled PDE inexactly because, you know, as I said, if we discuss the time dependent case, the PDE is very high dimensional. Solve the convergence theoretically instead of just you know. To implement. Okay, to easy to implement means actually we can write code very easily. Okay, and appropriate accuracy for sub problems. No, we don't want to solve the sub problems too accurately. And we don't want to solve the sub problems too loosely. Okay, so the appropriate accuracy is important. And also we don't want the algorithm to be dependent from the mesh size. Okay, when we discretize the you know the differential equations, mesh size you know really matters. So sometimes you know the mesh size is sometimes the performance is very sensitive to mesh size, and then when you use the fine mesh size, the performance could be very bad. So we don't want to see the independence from the mesh, and as I said, we want to guarantee the convergence recursively. So this is what we call the trustworthy algorithms. So I use the terminology from the software industry. Okay, they like use these words like trustworthy. Okay, it's trustable. Okay, so now this is the main result of the talk. So we are going to focus on the so-called parabolic PDE constraints, the optimal control problem. Okay, with control constraints. This is the model we are going to solve. So we have the parabolic equation, okay, and then we have a additional control constraints, which is a box, actually A and B, just a box constraints. Okay, and then everything is the same. Everything else is the same, okay, from the last model. So this is the parabolic PDE, okay? This is the additional constraints for control variable. Then we want to solve this model. Okay. And as I said, so first of all, we don't use semi-smooth Newton. Okay, the reason, as I said, is first of all, is because of the dimension. The dimension is very high because when we consider the space dimension and the time dependent, and then we use Newton, semi-smooth Newton, you have to solve the system very exactly, and this is very difficult to solve because of the high dimension. If you don't solve this exactly, then it seems like actually the theoretical result cannot be applied. Okay, and so we observe actually the reason of preventing semi-smooth Newton is simply just because, you know, when you use semi-smooth Newton, we don't differentiate the PDE constraints and the simple box constraints. We put these two constraints together. And correspondingly, the active set, you know, when we apply the semi-smooth Newton, we need to solve a Newton system. And then we need to observe the active set so that the, you know, the system, the active constraints can be identified, and then we can solve the system. And then the active set actually is different for each step, because just simply because of the box constraints. The box constraints change the active set all the time. Okay, so the changing active sets requires us to solve the system differently by different preconditioners. That's really very expensive. Okay, so that means for each iteration, although the number of semi-smooth Newton masses might be very small, less than 10 usually, but the, you know, for each step, there's a huge system to solve, and then the active set is different, and then you have to choose the preconditioner, you know, differently for each step. So another reason is because when we consider the error, the total error, okay, for solving the PDE constraints optimization problem, and then the total error actually consists of the discretization error and the iteration error. But you know, it's well known in PDE community. They said, okay, the discretization error actually dominates the total error. So that means sometimes high accuracy solutions may not be helped. Okay, to reduce the total error. So that means, okay, we just, you know, try this, maybe sometimes we just try the first order methods, okay, in order to solve them very quickly. Okay, that's the reason why we don't try semi-smooth for this method. Okay, so first of all, as I said, our recipe is, first of all, we decouple the constraints. We want to decouple the equation constraints with some simple constraints at the beginning, okay? And then for the notation, you know, we just use SU to represent the affine, the affine solution operator associated with the parabolic state equation. And then the model can just write in, you know, in the notation, we can write it easily with lighter notation. We have this parabolic equation. We have two objective functions minimized. And then we have one additional constant like this. And you'll see, actually, we can easily write, reformulate this model, but this way, okay, we put, we call this as one function, and then we introduce the indicator function to the objective function, okay? And we represent, to represent the constants. And then we have this function, okay, U and Z, and U must be equal to Z. So that's, we put SU in the objective, and this is the model we have to solve. And then, so we can use the Lagrangian, okay? And then we can use ADMM, for example. Okay, to solve this model conceptually, and then let's observe the two sub problems. Okay, the first sub problem is very simple. Just the first sub problem is actually take out the box constraints on U, and then we just do a projection, very easy. But the second sub problem is talking about the U. Okay, and then this problem actually is a standard unconstrained parabolic optimal control problem. Okay, so that's what I mean by decoupling the constraints by ADMM, by operator splitting. So we split these two constraints, and then the control constraints will not affect the PDE constraints. Okay, the box constraints on the control variable is just simply, you know, absorbed by this projection operator, and it's done. Okay, and then we can just leave. Black box, one shot, whatever you like to solve this problem. But again, the problem, the dimension is still very high. We just remove the constraints from consideration for the PDE, and then but the you know, the difficulty of the dimensions remains. So we still have to, you know, face the dimension. Okay, it's very high. How high? Okay, we can see if we use the mesh size, you know, by 1%, okay, 1/100, then the dimension could be, you know, a millions for D by 2, and there could be billions for D by 3. Okay, so that means we can only solve these problems, you know, inexactly. We apply black box or one-shot approach iteratively to solve this problem as an internal iteration, but still we can only target some inexact solution instead of the exact solution. Okay, so actually, even, you know, the dimension is, I mean, the reality is that the high dimension, you know, make us cannot solve these problems. But the, even we can solve this kind of sub problems, you know, accurately. Sometimes we don't have to do this because, you know, there's no justification to solve sub problems too accurately. Okay, especially at the beginning, at the first stage of iteration. So at the beginning, we prefer some very loose solutions. Okay, if you apply first order method. So that's why, so that means we want to solve the sub problem, the unconstrained parabolic problem, inexactly in this way. So the remaining problem is how to define the approximate equivalent, okay, theoretically and numerically. Okay, how to define this? And for example, we under which condition, under which criterion, and under which level of accuracy? Okay, how do we define this? So the details like this. So let's observe the unconstrained, you know, parabolic optimal control problem like this. And then the optimal condition is like this. So we can, there's a new variable, okay, P. P is just a joint variable, and it can be given by solving two equations, these two equations, okay. And by solving these two equations, we can get the optimal condition. And so we can define, just like when we solve system linear equation, we use the residual to define the accuracy, and then we use the residual of the unconstrained optimization problem, okay, to define the residual, to define the accuracy, and then we want to guarantee up to the accuracy, the residual can be controlled, can be decreased on this rate, okay. Sigma is just a constant, okay. It's constant between 0 and 1. So we just make sure actually the accuracy can be controlled by this way, and then we can guarantee the convergence. Okay, and this is the implementation of the inexact version, okay, of the AMM. So we compute the residual, we solve this problem, and then by solving, you know, PDEs, And then we consider the accuracy by, you know, checking this condition. And then after this condition is satisfied, we just move to the next step. And then the iteration is finished. Okay, so the features of the inexact version of the ADMM is, first of all, as I said, so we have to solve the sub problems inexactly, but sometimes, you know, we have to assign, we have set up accuracy before, okay, before we solve this problem. And how to set up the accuracy sometimes just depends on our experience without any theory, okay? Sometimes the accuracy might be too high or too low, we don't know. Okay, we just, you know, use some perceived, okay, accuracy to control the accuracy, to control sub problems. And for our accuracy, as you can see from the numerical result later, actually we can allow some medium or even very low accuracy solution of sub problems. That makes sense because, you know, that makes us to save computation, okay, and the mesh free, as I said, easy to implement and the convergence guarantee. So this is convergence. I don't want to show you the details. We can prove the convergence in the strong sense. And of course, we can estimate the convergence rate. Just like the ADMM for convex optimization problem. Okay, we can just extend all the theoretical results to this case. And this is a numeric experiment. We construct some data set and we know the solution. And then we know the exact solution, so just for the comparison. And then we can actually see the result. This is the result numerically. You see, basically, if you set up the accuracy by, you know, by perception, and sometimes we don't know which one is the right, you know, accuracy. So sometimes if you set accuracy very high, then, you know, time is long, okay? And if you set the accuracy very low, then there's no convergence, okay? No convergence means after 5,000 iterations in our experiment. And then if we use the automatically, you know, detected accuracy, then you know, we can just get in the save time a lot. Okay, so this is some artificial data sets, so we can verify actually the criterion can help us to detect the right accuracy automatically. Okay, we don't need to set up the accuracy, you know, too high or too low by experience. Okay, so this is, and solution is very very good. So solving the sub problems either too accurately or too inaccurately is not efficient, as we can show, as we can see from this table. Okay, -2 is too bad. -10 is too good. Okay, so both of the cases, the time is, you know, it's very long. We cannot get the convergence. And as I said, the inexact criterion finds a appropriate accuracy automatically. There's no need to set the accuracy a priori, okay, by experience or by perception. And if we look, you know, retrospectively, we know actually -4 is the best accuracy for the sub problem.
So before we have a question. We have a question.
Yes.
Can you show the accuracy control rule again?
You mean the sub problem?
Yeah, well, so the accuracy control rule. I don't know.
Accuracy is here.
This one.
Yeah.
Jonathan, any comment?
No, so, Jonathan, you mute. Yeah.
Yeah. So you're using, so it looks like it's just a geometric series type of rule, right?
Yeah.
Right. So you just say, I mean, it just has to be at least some amount smaller than the previous accuracy, right?
Yeah, kind of this. Yeah, roughly speaking, yeah.
So it's bounded above by a
bounded by a constant
geometric series. Yeah. So it's bounded above by a geometric series.
That's right.
Okay.
Okay. So we can say actually one advantage is that we don't need to set the constant's accuracy a priori. Okay, so we only we can save the computation, especially for some fine discretization mesh size case. Okay, and then this is and the convergence is still very fast, and the accuracy is not bad, so we get good accuracy solution. And one more advantage is based on our experiment is that the iteration are quite robust. Okay, I saw So Toten, raise your hand. So Rado, can you take the question?
Yes, Xiaoming, I'm Toten. I just want to ask a question. Your sigma is if you take beta equal to 3, sigma will be less than maybe 1/2. So if you iterate 100 times, then the accuracy will be underflow, I think. So how you resolve this issue?
Okay, you mean for some larger value of beta, right? Sigma is small, right? Is that right?
Yeah. So you cannot afford iterating more than maybe 50 iterations.
Yes. Yeah, but we don't have theory to do this, but you know, empirically, we all just observe very, very few numbers. You see, let me show you the results. I think only few steps. Yeah, only like 5 steps, okay, 7. Okay, this is the mean and the maximum CG steps for this, you see. So maximally, we can only less than 10 steps. We have some formula to estimate. So in another paper of mine, actually, we can estimate for the convex optimization scenario. But for this case, it's too complicated. We don't know how to estimate the number. But for optimization, for the standard optimization literature, we can do this.
These are the total CG steps that you take over the whole course of the algorithm?
No. Okay. For each step, for the sub problems, for each outer iteration. This is the number for the sub problems.
Okay, so you take 87, average of 87 CG steps per sub problem.
And I further answer Zoltan's question. So when you, for example, also this, the number is also depending on not just the beta, sigma, also depends on which preconditioner you are using. If you use good preconditioner, the number could be smaller. Okay.
So your average is more like 6 for your algorithm.
Xiaoming, another question.
Yes.
The question is if the accuracy depends on the PD discretization strategy.
Depends on what? PD is
on the discretization strategy.
Yeah. This, I think, of course, theoretically it depends, but numerically it's very robust, actually. This is something, we are still figuring out, Okay, so this is the curve, and this is the curves of our convergence. I skip it. So the extensions, let me look at the time. So, the extensions. We are focused on the parabolic case, but actually we can extend that idea, the same idea, to many other cases. For example, we can just replace the function, the objective function, by some L1 control costs functional. And also the distributed control variables U can be replaced by the Newman or Dirichlet boundary control variables. And the parabolic state equation can be easily replaced by many other linear PDEKs, like, for example, the elliptic equation, the wave equation, and some others. Okay, so we can just replace that. Idea is the same. Okay, as long as the PD is linear, I think it's okay to do this. So I list one more example, elliptic optimal control problems. This problem is easier than the parabolic because it's time independent. Okay, and for this problem, we apply the same idea. Okay, the main purpose of talking about this example is because we want to compare our method with the Samson's Newton, because Samson's Newton can solve this problem very, very efficiently. So there are many Samson's Newton methods, so we pick up this one, okay. We pick up this one, okay, this particular one, and we make, we just code by ourselves. And then we can compare, okay, I skip the details of the how to generate the data set. And then this is the implementation details. We use PCG, preconditional conjugate gradient, for the subproblems. And then we use everything from the paper of the Samson's Newton. And then we can compare these two approach. You see, for different age, actually our accuracy are almost the same, and the CPU time, the computing time can be saved by half if you use the first order ADM and PCG approach, Samson's Newton, for the elliptic equation case. Okay, that's a very simple comparison with Samson's Newton. Okay, so my main message is, okay, in addition to Samson's Newton, this first order algorithm can also be used for elliptic equation problems. Okay, but on the other hand, you know, as mentioned, if you want to use semi-smooth Newton to solve the parabolic case, the you know, we have many difficulties. Okay, to solve. Okay, to conclude. Well, first of all, it's generally not trivial to find some good solvers for PD constraints optimal control problems with additional control and or control state constraints. That's very complicated problems to solve. And then usually sometimes some algorithms which have been used successfully for optimization problems can be considered for you know for some cases for some of their control problems. Okay, and operator splitting, as I said, are promising for a lot of optimal control problems. I think the main reason is because by operator splitting we can split the PD constraints with some additional constraints instead of putting them together and sometimes unnecessarily complicated, you know, the resulting problems. And in particular, when we do the numerical algorithms, there are a lot of numeric linear algebra technologies, you know, to be used. We need precondition, we need, you know, some multi-grid method and the grid of subspace method. All of, you know, we end up with a lot of, you know, very difficult system of linear equations to solve. Now we need precondition, we need a lot of AMD, a lot of solvers, okay, to handle this kind of sub problems. My poster is basically, you know, taking care of these kind of issues. Okay, and we are also working on, as I said, in this talk, we focus on the case of linear PD constraints, but obviously we have many other much, much more challenging, you know, PDEs, like the Navier-Stokes or the Bose-Einstein equations. All of these equations are non-linear PDE, meaning non-convex optimization. Okay, if you consider the control problem. And we're also working on this, okay. We're making a little progress towards this as well. Okay, and this is the two reference that I based on in this talk. Okay, thank you very much.
So thank you very much, Xiaoming.
Yeah. Thank you.
Jonathan has lots of comments, questions. So Jonathan, two questions and first. Yeah, please unmute your mic.
Okay. So if I prioritize, I guess the most important one is, so this residual, okay, that you use for the subproblems, right?
Yes.
Can you relate that to standard measures of accuracy that might come out of the optimization community? Because, you know, there's been quite a lot of work on inexact ADMMs.
As I said, I can relate this in the sense of the residual of the system linear equations, for example, x equal b, and then we use x right. minus b as the residual. Yeah, the ideas comes from this, yeah.
Okay,
but of course, notation is much more complicated.
Because, you know, the original thing I published, you know, I did in 89, okay, was just based on the distance.
The distance of
the optimal solution, but
okay.
Recently I've several publications where you just look at subgradients. So you solve the sub problem until you get a subgradient that satisfies a certain condition.
Right.
So what I'm saying is, it may be possible to use like already created versions of the approximate ADMM.
Mm-hmm.
In this context, if you can relate, you know, the accuracy criterion of the PDE solver to the accuracy criteria that are used for those things. And so you might have alternative similar algorithms you could test against, or maybe it turns out it's equivalent.
Yeah.
I mean, the other major thing is, you know, in inexact procs and inexact ADMM, all these things, there are these relative error criteria.
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay, so the idea.
This is kind of relative error. You see this? Can you see my mouse?
No, it's not really, yeah. Because
not precisely, but relatively.
What happens when you do that in ADMM, what you get is you get a condition that says the accuracy at which you should solve the subproblem
right,
is related to how much the linking constraint was violated.
Yes.
Okay, so it's more adaptive than what you have.
Okay.
So it basically says, okay, if the linking constraint, you know, in the ADMM is not at all close to being satisfied, you don't need to solve the subproblem very, very. Okay. And so it's sort of smart because it basically, you know, there's one parameter in it which looks like this sigma, but it's actually different from your sigma. You're actually, this is even tighter than a fixed schedule using a geometric series.
Sure.
Okay. Because if you happen to get like a very accurate solution at one point, you gotta be more accurate than that next time.
Right.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, so I will follow. Yeah, I mentioned the papers with some you know Brazil guys. Yeah, Jonathan.
Yeah, I can send you the links. I mean, that's mostly the recent stuff I did with this graduate student named Wang Yao. But
okay,
all right.
Thank you. So, yeah.
I mean, there's a question asked by Steve Wright, which I also wanted to ask. So in your main result, I mean, actually what you have a smooth function, which you minimize over a box set. Yeah? So actually you don't need ADMM for that. You can use projected gradient.
Yes, I agree. But the problem is that the dimension is very high. When you consider the differential equation together.
Well, yeah. you need to figure out the Lipschitz constant, or use backtracking, because you're solving this complicated PDE.
Right.
You know, it's not. So it's like, okay, maybe that's a smooth function of the input, but what's the Lipschitz constant? You know.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, actually, you mentioned the L1 model. Okay, for that you have to use ADMM. Probably for the first model, yeah. You can use something which is simpler, let's say. So we have more questions. So the next question is, what is the time complexity of the algorithm?
Time complexity?
Yes.
Okay. It depends. I don't think we have a formula to reflect the time complexity, but you know we can observe the complexity from the time, from the convergence performance.
Okay.
Yeah.
There's another question.
I think second order, usually if we look at the numerical result, it's very close to second order. Yeah.
Okay. So another question is it possible to make the computations more efficient by use of a model reduction technique?
By model reduction?
Yes.
Sorry, I don't know. I'm not sure.
Okay, so Zhu Chenlin, why is sigma so special?
So special? Oh, that's
it's not. Inexact criterion again. Usually for inexact ADMM, we only require the error, the summation of the error to be finite. That will ensure the convergence of inexact ADMM. But you require very special.
Yes.
Criteria. Is it due to the discretization of the PDE?
No, this just because of the for the favor of convergence proof. Okay, and then we prefer constants instead of a sequence because constants is easy to fix. But if we have a sequence, then it's not easy to fix the sequence, right? You have to pick up that value step by step for each number. But here I've just fixed one constant for all iterations.
Right.
But the formula comes from the mathematical analysis, coming from the proof.
Yeah, but this error sequence will be summable. It's just the curious thing about it is it's linked to the. It's kind of linked to the penalty constant as well, which is a little bit unusual.
Yeah. Thank you, John.
Oh, there is an add-on by Steve Wright. I mean, related to projected gradient. So of course, you probably don't know the step size, but you can use backtracking.
Yeah,
backtracking, but it's very expensive. You have to compute a lot of PDEs to calculate the step size. Yeah, we have thought about this. Actually, for this work, I mentioned also another audience. Also, for this work, when we try to solve the Navier-Stokes equation control problems. we use this kind of approach. Yeah, exactly this approach. And there are a lot of trickies to do, to calculate the step size, because just because of the PDE, everything just became different.
Yeah. So you mean you have to solve the PDE every time you need to, you know, try out a different step size?
Right.
You have to solve it once, and you have to do that too often. Is that the problem?
Too often. Not the same one for once for all. No.
So is that because there are too many gradient projection iterations, or because there are too many failed steps?
I think, let me see. Okay. But are you talking about Navistock case or the case I mentioned at the top?
Well, I thought, yeah, the case with box constraints on the U.
Box constraints. Okay. But yeah, this one, if you use the conjugate gradient to solve, okay, let me see. Okay, for this one, right? So for this one, I think if you consider the box constraints with the PDE together, I think each step when you do the projection last step, then some coefficients in the PDE is changed, and then you have to solve the PDE from scratch.
What about two metric gradient projection? You know, where you sort of fix the activities and then do a Newton type step. That smells to me like semi-smooth Newton. It would be similar to semi-smooth Newton.
We didn't try, but for the semi-smooth Newton, as mentioned, actually, you have to choose the preconditioner for each iteration.
It would change when the activities change.
It's changing, and you need a lot of time to choose the preconditioner. And for our steps, we just do the preconditioner for once, and for all, and this preconditioner can be used all the time because the coefficient matrix doesn't change in the iteration.
Okay.
Only some constants item in the right hand side is changing, but the matrix doesn't change.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you, Steve.
Thank you, Steve. So another question from Vinbo. For a PDE control, how do I know whether a given desired output is reachable?
For the PDE control, how do I know?
Whether a given desired output is reachable.
I don't know, but you know, theoretically, we just solved this model and we assume YDE itself. I think some people have experience, or some people have some simulation, and then they know they have some desired state. Okay. I cannot answer this question.
Okay, another question. Do you know how to use deep learning?
That's elastic
differential equations to solve PDEs.
That's a very good question. Initially, I want to include a little bit discussion in this, but I removed them because we're still working on this.
Okay.
Yeah, for PDE, for machine learning, deep learning, many people are working on PDE or some data-driven, you know, modeling by deep learning. And we are considering how to use, as I said, for some sub-problems like this, sub-problems, if you have PDE solvers, then we can embed PDE into this service. But in this talk, I'm just talking about how to design an algorithm for the overall problems. And I don't know too much about how the deep learning is being used for control. But I know many people are working on applying deep learning to PDE, not control. So my conclusion is that when you have some very good solver for some particular PDE, and then we can consider the PDE constraints optimization, and then we use the deep learning for the sub problems like this.
Good. So three more questions. Jonathan Eckstein first. Okay, Jonathan. It's your turn, Jonathan. Jonathan?
Oh, yeah. So I had a question actually about the strong convergence.
Yes.
Because, you know, generally in infinite dimensional space, proximal algorithms only have weak convergence. Unless you do this, you know, Hogazo trick where you.
He has strong convexity in objective.
Oh, it's strong convexity. Okay.
Yes, convex. Yes.
Okay.
It's strong convex. Yes.
Okay.
Because of the additional term for the energy.
Okay.
Then Louis Briceño, would you please ask your question?
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I was wondering if because your objective function is quadratic, then by using Chambord box splitting and adaptive step sizes, you should have big O of 1/k².
Yes.
Yeah, I don't know if you have tried that kind of algorithm.
Yeah. Very good question. We are trying. Actually, my student, one of my students is working on this. Yeah. And okay. We are comparing which one is better. We don't know. Sometimes, you know, for the trombone pox algorithm, sometimes I give you the very short conclusion about our preliminary results. Okay. When this alpha is not very small, sometimes the trombone pox method works better. But when alpha is very small, like -5, -10, or -6, then ADMM works better. we're doing this, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Very good question.
Xiaoming, last question. It will be my question. So let us look at the nonlinear case, which is actually the most interesting one. Yeah? So nonlinear solution operator. So what are you doing there? Are you evaluating or are you linearizing in every iteration the operator? Like do a kind of linearization?
No, for the nonlinear case, it has nothing to do with operator splitting. as just as Steve mentioned, we can use like use the CG method or use some projection gradient method. Yeah, have nothing to do with operator splitting.
And you know, there are some algorithms doing splitting for nonlinear operators. Yeah, there are some recent papers on this.
Oh, okay, very good. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah.
So where you like linearize and then evaluate
it. But I don't know. I just think about the non-convex case of for optimization. I mean, it's very everything's different for the
analysis. Yeah. I agree.
Yeah.
So then let us stop here. So nice talk, Xiaoming. Nice
thank
questions. Nice
thank you for attending. Yeah, thank you all.
Thank you very much. No, it's 10 o'clock, in Hong Kong, I guess.
All right, thank you very much. Yeah, thank you.
Good night and
thank you.
Yes. So if you have more questions, just write emails to the speaker.
Yes.
Yeah? And so we will post the slides and we'll post the video on the website, and we will meet next week for the last talk given by Coralia Kartic of the first season. Yeah? So have a nice week. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
Bye bye.
Bye bye. Bye bye.
Thanks. Bye.